Morning, everybody.
How are you doing?
If you could turn your Bibles to John chapter 8, you can just stay there for a minute. It's great to be here in light of the very depressing events that took place last night concerning a certain college basketball game. Nothing better to lift the spirits than seeing everybody's smiling face. So we are going to come to the cross and keep your finger in John 8. Start you off with a story. I remember in my younger days, I was really into Legos. I love Legos like crazy. Easily my favorite thing was playing with Legos. And so, after years of just building with Legos and just having lots of fun with it, my parents would give me a new Lego set. And, they come with the little directions in the box. And I thought I was the coolest kid. I'd open the box, I'd take the directions, and go, down here. And I would, just try to look at the box and, spot it up and build it myself. And then, after, a good hour of, looking at the thing, and I'm like, something's wrong here. I'm not getting this. This is not working. And I'm like, okay, I'll look at the directions. I know what I'm doing. I'm just going to look at it and make sure they got it right.
Come on.
So, after trying everything I could do, I would look at the directions and be like, I can see it. I'd be like, okay, I need to know how to do this right. And that story is very very reminiscent of how I came to Jesus. I was trying a bunch of things. I was trying to make myself happy. I was trying to fulfill myself, and nothing was working. And, in the back of my mind, it was always, okay, you go to church every week, and all those people are really happy and fulfilled, so I guess I should, maybe there's something there.
Come on.
Go, Taylor.
And I was tired of hurting myself, I was tired of hurting other people, and in keeping with our theme, it took a real transformation, it took a real mind change.
Yeah.
When I was coming to Jesus to understand really what the cross meant,
Amen.
The significance of it. In John 8, in verse 12.
Come on, Taylor.
When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And I read that, and I feel like when I was beginning, I was slowly beginning to understand that through the cross, it was like Jesus saying to me, you've been doing it wrong, you're living your life wrong, and now you have the opportunity to live it right. Mm-hmm. Take advantage of that. Don't waste it. And, for the last year and a half, the more that I put into practice these qualities that Jesus exemplified in his life, the better everything gets. My attitude is better.
Uh-huh.
My mood is better. Especially my relationships with people. And that brings me to my second scripture. John 17, verse 20.
Come on, Taylor. Good stuff.
Verse 20, this is Jesus' last night. He's praying. He says, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I and them and you and me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me.
Amen.
What this scripture makes me think of is just the family that I got when I came to God and I started being close and I became a disciple and I became a part of this church. And for me, that's probably the best part of being here. I remember we had that Midwest conference a couple months ago, and I was, that Sunday I was looking around and I'm like, there's 4,000 people here, and we're all just like family, and people out of nowhere are like giving me hugs, and we're all having a great time, and that's just because we all came to Jesus for the same reason.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
And so even though, I hear the communion message every week, and I'm reminded of it. There are reminders everywhere, like in my quiet times, and there are phrases on billboards and things like Jesus died for the sins of the world. There are all these reminders, but it doesn't lose its significance when I consider everything that it's given me, namely just the chance to live, righteous, fulfilling life, and to have this amazing family that's unlike anything on earth. So,
amen.
In light of all that, let us pray.
Good stuff.
Lord, it's so great to come to you this Sunday morning. It is always humbling to think of the sacrifice that you made for us, to think about everything that it gives us, the general things, the more broad things, but also means something different to every individual, because our relationship with you, it is en masse and it's very individual as well. I thank you so much for this wonderful family. It's so wonderful to know that no matter what the situation is, the circumstances, no matter what's going on in life, that you're always going to have people who love you and support you, want to be there for you. Thank you for the opportunity to live our lives right, to be close to you. And I think those are the greatest blessings that you've given us before you give us anything else. And I pray that you would allow us to remember these things as we go throughout our week. I pray this in the name of your Son. Amen.
Amen.